ports are getting bigger and bigger, but does that necessarily mean that air travel is going to be a less frustrating experience for us passengers?
You'll be able to step out of your car or off the train and straight onto your plane and off you go.
Also coming up, we tell you where to dine in Paris. And we follow the trail of the forest-dwelling Batois people. I'm Fiona Foster, welcome to Fast Track. Now, when it's completed next year, this will be Dubai's super jumbo terminal. And in typical Dubai fashion, it is enormous. But when it comes to airports of the future, will biggest always mean best? What will the airport of the future look like? Well, with forecasts suggesting air passenger numbers will more than double worldwide by 2030, one thing you can bet on is it will be big. Greg Lindsay is co-author of a book which puts forward the idea that the future belongs to the Aerotropolis, the city created with an airport at its heart, not at its edges.
Cities have always formed around transportation. The port cities of Europe were created around their docks. The railroad cities of America, like Chicago and New York, were created around their train stations. And the idea is that in the 21st century, if you're China or India or the Middle East, you're creating cities around airports because it's the only way to connect to the global economy.
And in some parts of the world, construction of these aerotropolises has already begun.
The most interesting examples are in Asia, if you want to see what it looks like to build a city from scratch around nothing. I mean, maybe the most examined case is Songdo, South Korea, where literally an American developer is building a $35 billion city from scratch on a man-made island about the size of downtown Boston.
If there's anywhere that already represents this idea of a city created from scratch because of its ability to connect people through its airport, it's Dubai.
Over the last 25 years, we never stopped developing. And I think it will go on as long as you have growth. You need to develop, you need to build more and more, and that would be the case.
And this tiny emirate has massive ambitions for its future as it plans a new terminal for Dubai International and the gargantuan Al Maktoum Airport down the road, which will have five runways, serve 160 million people, and will be double the size of the largest airport in the world today. But is it possible to be too big?
I think if it's based around current thinking and current technology, the answer is yes, because if you continue to add to a conventional airport model, the walking distances get longer, you're putting more and more people into very focused areas. So actually for our new airport, we are thinking very differently about what the optimal size is.
And for the mega airports of tomorrow, this will mean finding ways of giving huge numbers of people the impression of an intimate experience.
We're thinking about distributing terminals in a much greater number than now, integrating surface transport. So if you come here by rail or by car, you'll be able to get very, very close to your departing aeroplane, and the signage and the technology will direct you there. So you'll be able to step out of your car or off the train into a very comfortable, modest-sized facility and straight onto your plane and off you go.
Greg Lindsay agrees that new airports require new thinking.
There's no problem with the airport being too big. It's a question of, did you design it to be that big? I mean, the problem we have in Europe and America is that we built our airports before we really knew what they were for. We built them, you know, either through accident or we built them, you know, in the sort of luxury jet age when few people could fly. And now, you know, air travel's evolved into this sort of mass transit, essentially. And so, you know, we end up with cramped airports that we can't expand.
Does your office have an airport?
And being left on the sidelines in this brave new world of airport expansion is something which is worrying European experts.
In Asia and in the Middle East, what we're seeing is an airport capacity race. In Europe, it's exactly the contrary. For airports, getting their license to operate and to grow is increasingly difficult. And it's very clear from independent reports that we will not have enough capacity in Europe to deal with a doubling of the traffic by 2030.
The new Berlin-Brandenburg International Airport will be built at Schönefeld by 2012.
Airport building is underway in Europe. In Berlin, for example, which is replacing its three old airports, including the historic Tempelhof, with the brand new $3 billion Berlin-Brandenburg International, due to open next year. But such projects are few and far between.
In China, the government has a plan to build 78 new airports by 2020. In contrast, in Europe, we have at the moment plans for building just 5 airports by 2030.
The sky trains actually take people into the bottom of the building.
In Dubai, the new A380 terminal, designed especially for the 90 double-decker planes Emirates have ordered, is taking shape. It'll have 3 levels dedicated to different class ticket holders, the lowest level being for economy passengers.
On the upper level up there, you can see there's 2 more floors. The first floor will be the first class lounge area. That stretches virtually the entire length of the building, which is 625 metres long. And the good thing about that level and the level above, which is the business class level, is our customers will be able to board directly from the lounge straight onto the upper deck on the A380, of which there'll be 20 aircraft parked at any time around the building.
Something which Emirates hope will prevent what at the moment can be a rather chaotic A380 boarding process at Dubai. To make passengers' lives easier and to make sure they spend as much as possible, of course, state-of-the-art technology will play its part in any airport of the future.
For example, why call people to the gate room and board the aeroplane so early when they could actually be relaxing, spending money in the shops, enjoying a coffee? So what we'd like to do is get interactive technology so that people are called to the gate, maybe via their mobile phone or on their boarding pass, just when the aircraft is ready to go, so there's a minimum of delay before departure.
But no matter how big or state-of-the-art airports of the future will be, there's one aspect of modern-day travel that they won't be able to ignore, and that is ever-increasing security.
Security, it's a complex issue. At the one ultimate extreme, you've got Total Recall, you know, where Arnold Schwarzenegger walks through the tunnel and they can immediately see his muscle-rippling body with all the sort of weapons he has on it. And that's kind of a vision of the future. I mean, that's not too far removed from the technology we have. The problem is you have issues of privacy, and ultimately you have the issue of cost.
As more and more cities ponder how to cater for the 12 billion of us predicted to be flying in 20 years' time, Greg Lindsay remains convinced that the Aerotropolis is the model for the future.
Do we think of airports as the ultimate nuisances and something we banish to the edge of our cities and then surround it with steel mills and other horrible polluting and inconvenient things? Or do we think of them as integral to sort of the future and the health of our city, and we build around them in intelligent ways? You know, we create transit, we create denser neighborhoods around them. I mean, airports are an opportunity for older cities to really sort of fix the neighborhoods that matter most and really sort of, you know, connect to the world in ways that we haven't done.
So what are your thoughts? Would you get to the airport early so you could have a quick dip in the pool or maybe do some serious shopping? And what would be in your fantasy airport of the future? As ever, we'd love to hear your thoughts. Do let us know. You can email us at fasttracktravel@bbc.co.uk. Now let's have a look at what else is making the news in the travel world this week. Lufthansa has unveiled a new in-flight entertainment system, which means that passengers will be able to watch in-flight movies on their own tablets and other mobile devices. The German carrier Condor will be the first to introduce the new system, which is also being offered to other airlines around the world.
It's a completely new system from the airline, from an in-flight entertainment point of view, because you don't have necessarily in-flight in-seat screens. And also the airline doesn't have to give you a device, because now you can use basically any device you have with you.
There's been some good news for the tigers featured in last week's Fast Track. India's tiger census has shown numbers of the endangered species are slowly beginning to increase. The Indian government said the rise was positive news for conservation efforts, but stressed that the animal is still under threat. A tour operator has said hotel prices for the London 2012 Olympics are vastly inflated. They're challenging the British Hospitality Association, which claims hotels are not profiteering from the Games.
That's not what we're currently finding in the marketplace. Rates are in fact significantly higher in 2012 than the rates were being offered in 2011. And terms and conditions are far more onerous and in many cases unworkable.
A baboon who attacked tourists and raided cars in Cape Town has been captured and put down. The monkey, known as Fred, was one of around 400 baboons who roamed the city searching for food. The decision to have him euthanized was made after he injured three people.
Stay with us, because coming up after the break, we tell you where to dine in Paris as part of this month's Insider Guide, and we follow the trail of the forest-dwelling Batwa people.